Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. What's in a name? You know, I remember a time a while back when my now former nephew used to grill me. He was a very committed Southern Baptist, and you know, he didn't know about these Episcopalians and wanted to know whether we believed right or not. You know, and somehow or another we began to talk about church history. You know, I said, well, the Episcopal Church, you know, has started, you know, with broke away from the Catholic Church in the 1500s, but it really goes back, you know, even into the second or third centuries. You know, and the Baptist Church really was founded in the 1500s as a breakaway movement, you know, from all the other churches that were around. And Zachary said, oh, no, that's not right. Baptists go all the way back to Jesus' time. I said, well, how do you know that? He said, well, the first Baptist was John the Baptist. I said, how can I argue with that? And so, you know, and then I thought about it. You know, yeah, okay, John was the first Baptist, but he also was the first Episcopalian. He was the first Catholic. In a very real way, he was the first Christian. He really is the first human being whose life was lived in relationship and with a relationship with Jesus of Nazareth. You know, now, if he is the first Christian, if he is our model, that's not necessarily good news because, of course, it also says he ate locusts and wild honey. So, but that's not the John the Baptist we need to follow. There are several aspects of John's life, you know, that are really, that made him distinctively a follower of Jesus. And I think those same things can make a difference in our lives, helping us to be distinctively Christian in a world that often, you know, wants to make us less distinctively Christian. Things like John the Baptist was called by God and he lived his life out of that call. He pointed not to himself, but he pointed to the one who is the light. And secondly, he was aware of the one who is here, but not necessarily always recognized. Today's gospel begins with some words from the prologue to the Gospel of John. Now, there's John the gospel writer, and there's John the Baptist. I'll try to keep them separated. But John the gospel writer begins his gospel with some of the greatest words in all of Scripture. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God, and not without him was not anything made that was made. Wonderful, exalted poetry that talks about, you know, Jesus being the Logos, the Word, the organizing principle. And he goes along until about verse 6, and then he suddenly detours, and he starts, and John, the gospel writer, starts talking about John the Baptist. And we see it in today's gospel reading. There's a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify to the light, so that all might believe through him. He himself was not the light, but came to testify to the light. You know, John, the gospel writer, frequently talks about John the Baptist, but generally not in exalted terms. Not in, you know, he generally wants to spend his time subordinating John the Baptist to Jesus of Nazareth. He tells us again and again who John is not. John is not the Messiah. He is not the light. He is not Elijah, you know, on and on and on. And you know, you would think, why would he spend so much time and energy doing that? Well, in the first century, not everybody got this. You know, there's a writer and a historian named Josephus. He was a Jewish general who lost the war, and in his captivity, he wrote a history of the Jewish people. And when he got to the first century, he actually spent a lot more time writing about John the Baptist than he did about this teacher and rabbi named Jesus of Nazareth. He kind of missed the main guy. In Acts chapter 19, St. Paul, in his travels, runs into a community, and they were kind of confused. And he said, well, tell me about your community. Who baptized you? And he said, well, we were baptized in the John's baptism. And Jesus and Paul would say, well, there's more in store for you. And so John was not the Messiah. He was not many things, but he was three things at least. The first one was, he was sent by God. We know that because his story is an amazing story. His story is found really in the first chapter of the Gospel of Luke, where you have this wonderful, faithful couple, Zechariah and Elizabeth. They lived their lives faithfully, but yet they didn't have any children, and they always were grieving, you know, that loss, that empty spot in their lives. And while Zechariah was in the temple worshiping, God came to him and said, you are going to have a son, but not just any son. Luke tells us, even before his birth, this child will be filled with the Holy Spirit. He will turn many of the people of Israel to the Lord their God. With the spirit and power of Elijah, he will go before them to turn the hearts of the parents to their children, to the disobedient, to the wisdom of the righteous, and to make ready a people prepared for the Lord. From the very beginning, John had a call. He had a purpose. He had meaning in his life. And as he lived into that ministry, it had a tremendous impact in the world, in the culture around him. And being successful, having an impact, aroused the interest and the curiosity of the religious authorities. And so what we read in today's gospel was that this is the testimony sent by John when the Jews sent priests and Levites from Jerusalem to ask him, "Who are you? Who are you?" He confessed and did not deny it, but confessed, "I am not the Messiah." And they asked him, "Well, what then? Are you Elijah?" And he said, "I'm not. Are you the prophet?" And he answered, "No." And what happened there was they were using almost technical terms. You know, they had these preconceived notions of what a dynamic religious leader was supposed to be. They thought maybe John the Baptist was like the Messiah. And the Messiah was a person, the Savior. It was going to be like David or Judas Maccabeus, who was going to rise up and cast off the oppressors and let the Jews live in freedom and harmony. That wasn't John's mission. And he says, "Well, are you Elijah?" Malachi said, "Well, Malachi was the one who prophesied that Elijah would come before the great and terrible day." Well, John the Baptist wasn't that either. His was to come before a great and wondrous day, the birth of the king. Then they asked him, "Well, are you a prophet?" And again, you know, they were thinking about a verse in Deuteronomy where Moses told the people of Israel, "The Lord your God will raise up for you a prophet like me from among your own people. You shall heed such a prophet." Well, John the Baptist was a prophet, but he was not that prophet. His role was different than what the expectations of the religious authorities. You know, the reality was that John the Baptist's mission didn't fit into their ideas, into their little boxes, you know, that they had. He refused to be defined by the world around him, but instead, he was defined by his relationship with the living God. I think that's the same promise, the same possibility, the same reality for us as well. You know, you and I have an identity, but what is it? What is it? You know, we are constantly identified. The world seems to constantly identify us and put us in boxes by class, by age, by race, by ethnicity, by lifestyle choices, by politics. You know, the list goes on and on and on. But none of those by themselves define you or define me. So how can we find identity in a deepest sense? How can we find meaning and purpose, an energizing thing that helps us understand the dignity that we are given as God's children? Obviously, it is as we live into our relationship, our call that God has given us. You know, as people who are baptized, we have been welcomed into the family of God. We are God's children. We are part of the family of God, empowered to make a difference. You know, John the Baptist's awareness of his call, his purpose, gave him power to live life and make a powerful, powerful difference. As we understand who we are in God's eyes, as we understand the call God gives us, I think we too can have an added dignity and power that we wouldn't have otherwise. Well, what was John the Baptist's purpose? Again, in the beginning, he says, you know, that he came as a witness to testify to the light so that all might believe through him. You know, those are legal terms. He was a witness called to testify. So there he was, you know, on the dock. And what was he saying? He said, "Well, I'm not the guy, but that's the guy. I'm not the light, but he is the light." And later on in the lesson, he would go on. He said, "Well, what then? Who are you? Let us have an answer for those who sent us. What do you say about yourself?" And John said, "I am the voice of one crying out in the wilderness, 'Make straight the way of the Lord,' as the prophet Isaiah had said." John the Baptist was called to be a witness. He was called to cry out. He was called to make the path straight for the one who was to follow. His role was to point to Jesus. You see, Augustine once said that John the Baptist was a voice for a time, but Jesus was the eternal word. John himself would say a couple chapters later in the Gospel of John that he, Jesus, must increase, but I must decrease. And it's a powerful thing. And for us, I think it is the same, that we, again, find our purpose when we point not to ourselves, but instead when we point to Jesus. I remember it was a powerful thing. And I used to work at camp when I was in South Texas. And, you know, one year we had a kind of a not a great year. And one of the problems was that the camp's counselors were rock stars. But they thought of themselves as rock stars. You know, and it was about them and how cool they were and how many kids they could influence about themselves and what fun things they could do for their kids, you know, that usually broke the rules, you know. And, there was a problem. So the next year, the head of this program, who later became the bishop, Gary Lillibridge, used this verse. He must increase and I must decrease. And he just pounded that message into the counselors, and they bought it. And they spent the next year not being rock stars, but by pointing to Jesus. And in pointing to Jesus, they were truly rock stars. And I think for us, it's much the same. You know, we can spend our lives pointing to ourselves. We can preen after we score a touchdown, or we can spend our lives pointing to the one who's greater, the one who offers us life and health and hope and salvation. And as we do that, I think we find life and purpose. But then, of course, the word ends, you know, so he goes on talking about this. And by then, of course, John's inquisitors were thoroughly, thoroughly confused. Verse 25 says, what then? You know, what are you doing? Why are you baptizing if you're neither the Messiah nor Elijah nor the prophet? And John answered them, I baptize with water. Among you stands one whom you do not know, the one who is coming after me. I am not worthy to untie the thong of his sandal. Yes, he was pointing to Jesus, but it says, among you stands one whom you do not know. Among you stands one who is unrecognized. Now that is kind of ominous, isn't it? But for us who believe, we do recognize, we do know who's the one who stands among us. You know, it is, of course, the risen Jesus. It is great news. You know, and it really, it is this reality that we encounter a Jesus who is not seen, but very real and very present in all that we do as a church. It's why we do all this crazy Christian stuff week by week and year by year and day by day. You know, that we can recognize Jesus in our midst. And we do it in all sorts of ways. You know, Jesus himself says, whenever two or three are gathered, I am here in the midst of you. It also happens, I think, even when we pray, especially when we pray in the ways that Christians have prayed for centuries, in ways that have opened doors to the holiness, to the liturgy that we do Sunday by Sunday. It happens when we pray both in heart, but also in voice, as we sing, as we make music. It happens when we see Jesus in, as Mother Teresa said, Jesus in his disturbing disguise, when we reach out to the least among us, when we care for those who are outcasts, when we do outreach or service. I think most of all, we see the power of this unseen but very present Jesus when he takes ordinary things and makes them extraordinary. When he takes common things and makes them holy. When he takes sinners and makes them saints. When he takes bread and wine and transforms them into his body and into his blood. And as we take the communion, take the Eucharist week by week, we realize, you know, that Jesus is not just here, but he's here inside us at work, calling us, empowering us to new life in all its fullness. John pointed to a God who is here, but a God who is often unrecognized. You know, there's a prayer in a prayer book that says, open our eyes that we might see your hand at work in the world about us. Recognizing that God is indeed present, that he's here, that he's among us, I think is one of those ways that we can see clearly as we travel our path. Realizing, you know, that God is present, that we are indeed on the right path, that we are Christians, and that Christianity is working for you and for me. And so, you know, John the Baptist probably was the first Baptist, but he also was the first Christian. And I think, you know, we live in a world where as Christmas draws ever closer, you know, the meaning of Christmas seems to be less and less emphasized. Well, I think John the Baptist reminds us to who we are. You know, that we are called as Christians. We are called into a relationship with him. We are called to a purpose, to a mission, to a ministry. We also, that ministry is the point to one who is not us, but the point to the one who is the light, the one who has chosen us the way. And lastly, to celebrate the reality that this Jesus who is about to come is not just coming, he's here in your heart and in mine, alive and at work. And for that, we give thanks. Amen.